Vision of Oneness shows a different picture, different liberation. So what people are trying to do in spiritual dualism is to say, I'm one with all preferences. All these preferences are fine with me. I'm all one with that, so to speak. That's not quite it. Because at the bottom of that is the belief deep belief that they believe that God had at least one preference. God has at least one preference. There's at least some specialness, at least a core specialness somewhere. And they don't want to let go of that belief. So they cover that up by this show of spirituality. Of I'm not attached to form. I'm not attached to preferences. Look at all the stuff I'm walking away from. Walking away from all that, I'm not attached to it. But they're still feeling that makes me special. So this permeates the society right now. It permeates the society. Which makes us extremely vulnerable then to materialism. Because it seems to give us the vehicle to promote a sense of spirituality in us. Because look at all the stuff that I'm donating to Goodwill today. Got a whole truckload of stuff I'm bringing down to Goodwill. I'm not attached to that stuff anymore. I'm streamlining. I'm simplifying. Look, I replaced these gadgets with this one gadget. You know, I'm not attached to those gadgets. I got just one gadget. You know, it's better. So it gives this sort of form of non-attachment, which is a superficial appearance, where actually they're deeply attached to the belief that there has to be some specialness. They're just pretending to not identify and say, well, I'm not attached to any particular specialness, but there has to be specialness. It's like all the different relationships, you know, divorce and change relationships and stuff. They're saying, I'm not attached to any relationship, any special relationship. I'm just flowing with it. But what they're trying to show is, I'm not attached to any particular relationship, but I am attached to the principle of specialness. I'm not giving that up. It's like a compromise. You say, I'm not going to give it up, because the continuity fear seems so difficult to deal to tackle. So. This is kind of just a state of the world address here. It's turning into that. Because none of those people give evidence of this overflowing bliss, of realization, of vision of oneness. They don't give any evidence of that. I haven't seen it anywhere, actually. So it can't be true that this is what's liberating them. It's not. It's perplexing, too, because it seems like, from a theory, you know, it seems like plausible, right, that this is helpful in liberating them. Now, anything can be used to be helpful for the continuity problem if you remain humble and continue to make breakthroughs. But these people do not seem humble. There's another sign there, telltale sign. They seem very proud of their spiritual accomplishments, of their spiritual attainment. But that the spiritual pride is not just the radiant, unbounded bliss of the vision of oneness. It is not. So there's all these red flags in the world, all these red flags about what's going on. I think these spiritual materialists who think they're very advanced are actually planning to be the new rulers and bureaucrats, rulers of the New World Order, thinking that they know how to set us free, make us happy. Which is this, out with the old, in with the new. Let's just, you know, keep everything flowing here in this world of, oh, here's a new, new preference. Your new preference is here. Your new specialist is here. Tired of the old specialist? No problem. Don't get attached to specialists. Just get the new specialist. Specialist. Like that. Oh, man. That's... Tired of your old love? Here's a new love. Free love, they call it. The free love movement. Free awareness, free love, free this. Very tricky, clever situation. But the answer is never in form. It's never in form. It's never in form. Vision of oneness is a whole different situation that you need to prepare for. Need to prepare for, and the preparation for that is very intense. Can take a long time, and you stumble along. I'm still preparing for it. As you get wealthy, you tend to go into this spiritual materialism, this dualistic spiritual, because you can travel everywhere, you can buy all these things, and so you feel kind of free of specialness because you can always afford to get rid of whatever you have and get something new. So there's a tendency for those in the wealthy classes, etc., to develop the spiritual duality and to think that they're the ones who need to rule the world, to show the world how to be happy, how to be spiritual. And so that's what's happening. There's this class of spiritual entitlement in the world that has arisen, and they feel that they know how to bring happiness to the world. This is the situation here. Now they call, the term Lucifer refers to this false light, false idea of happiness, false light, false idea of happiness. And that's certainly playing out in this world. This Luciferian idea of the false light, false happiness is very much what's happening in this world. That's quite deceptive. We're seeing through it right now, but the continuity problem is such that I have to go slowly here for you and for myself. I have to go slowly because don't struggle trying to figure it all out. Don't struggle. We're just bringing this to light. That's all we're doing. That's good enough. We're getting the maybe here. We're getting the maybe. So when you make a big push, you need to take a little break kind of and catch your breath. Now, this is heavy material work we're going through here. So getting free of this false light, false path, is, you know, the goal. It's the goal. So of course it's difficult. Absolutely. The continuity problem, we're so used to this, and we find out that it's mistaken, is quite a shock. To really see it as mistaken is quite a shock. Because for so long, you know, we thought, hey, maybe this is it. Maybe this is it. The realization is God never had any preferences. There's never been any preferences, and never will be. The spiritual materialists, the false lighters, they went to Sri Nandamayama and says, look, we'll put you as the head of our new world religion. The whole world will worship you. We'll put you at the head of it. So why? So you legitimize the rest of us. She says, no. No deal. Tells you right there, no deal. So they're desperate to find, put someone at the head to legitimize it. To legitimize it. So the fact that they picked a woman, tried to say, Sri Nandamayama is a woman, say, we want you as the head of this new world order, new world religion. She said, no. Means they're certainly willing to put a woman at the head, and I think they will. They absolutely will. But it could be a man too. Could be. It could be a woman definitely as well. It seems it's going in that direction. You know, a lot more, but we'll see. They want to legitimize it, you see. If Sri Anandamayi would have said yes, and at the head of that, it would have seemed to have legitimized the whole thing. And she said no, which tells you where God's at on this whole thing. No, no, it's not of God. It's not of God. Just like they asked Jesus, Jesus will make you king of this world. Jesus said no, said no. That tells you where God's at, right? No. Gonna do it. So and they said, okay, we'll do it for you. You may not be here, but in your absence we'll do it for you. And you see, that's what happens here in this world. They say well, Jesus, you know, you made a mistake. They'll say, oh, you made that one mistake, Jesus. You should have said yes. And I know when you're going to come back, you're going to reconsider. In a couple thousand years, you'll come back and you'll reconsider and say, okay, I accept. So we're going to get all ready for you. And so when you come back, we know you're going to say yes. So we're going to act as if, you know, you're going to say yes to us. So we don't give up easily, do we? We don't give up easily. Jesus is still going to say no. Still gonna say no. What we really want is to believe that all this form, our bodies form, everything, that is God's preference for us. And if Jesus were to come here and to rule this world, that would prove it. We say, see, it is God's preference. We don't have to work on any boundless happiness, total freedom. You know, we don't have to worry about that. This is proven that this is our home. This is our preference. God has preferences for us, so we're, you know, it, so we hold on to that. We hold on to that for a long time. We hold on to that. We absolutely hold on to that. And then people say, whoa, 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 too fast, too fast, too fast. Well, that's the whole point of the spiritual path, is you do these wind sprints. It's part marathon, part wind sprint. You get tired, you say, wow, let me just, this is a wow thing, you know, wow. But here it's understood that is, you are doing the work. When you get to the wow, you're doing the work. So it's all good. The backlashes come, and you just don't struggle with it. You just don't struggle with it. You don't entertain it. You don't struggle with it. You don't entertain it. You don't argue against it. It's very important. Don't entertain it. Don't struggle. Don't argue. Because you get to this inner wow, you're doing the work. Don't rate it. Don't number it, don't catalog it, don't evaluate it, don't struggle, don't argue, don't deny, don't, you know, all this, just stay with the wow. Says, wow, okay, be positive, thank you, continuity problem, thank you, Holy Spirit, thank you, continuity problem, doing a good job here, moving me along here, bit by bit. So you just stay with this wow of the breakthrough. You just stay with it. You just stay with this. Don't try to make it more. Don't try to make it less. Just let it be what it is. It's you know, it's the burn. Like when you exercise, you get this burn, and you say, wow, I really did it. You know, I'm really doing some intense exercise here. That's great. Now the burn hurts. You got to rest for a little while. And just wait till the burn goes away. You know, you could use that analogy. Just wait till the burn. This is a spiritual burn. You know, or spiritual burning. These exercises are burning away the continuity fear, evaporating it. So we will feel like, wow, what a spiritual burn that is. You know, that's it. And we're not in competition with anyone. Neither are we trying to establish some plurality either. So the whole masculine feminine thing, the way it's the yin yang dichotomy, you know, is the masculine tends to say, let's compete here, let's compete. And the feminine said, no, let's get this plurality, let's get this consent. Neither one of those are in play. Neither one of those are in play. That's why the Course in Miracles is self-study. It is not to have these plurality groups that women tend to form. It is not to have these institutions which men tend to form, like competitive, aggressive, competitive. You know, I'm getting more. How much burn are you getting? I think I'm getting more than you. Let's get more. You know, it's neither one of those. It's neither one of those. That's why I say, you know, institutions either way, male or female, is not it. It's not it. That's why I say patriarchy is not it. Feminism, matriarchy is not it. Patriarchy is not it. Matriarchy is not it. Either one are it. Going from one to the other, one to the other is getting nowhere. They're taking turns. Say, well, it's our turn, you got a turn. That's not, it gets nowhere. That's silliness, juvenile silliness. Avoiding the situation. You manage your situation. Your continuity fear. Say, I have a severe continuity fear, and that's the only problem I have. The only division line resolves this problem for me. That's it. There isn't any other resolution. So you stay within your wow that you're getting. Don't worry about what someone else's wow is. Problem with any teaching situation where people come in for a teacher is they tend to either institutionalize in one way or the other, in a competitive way or a consensus way. Masculine or feminine, tends to, you know, go that direction one way or the other. And sometimes there's both there. There's sometimes both. But what are you going to do? Sri Nanda Mama said, I'm not establishing any religion. I'm not establishing any following. I'm not even establishing any ashrams. I'm not asking anyone to do anything for me. So it doesn't seem to be much that she did at all. It's just, you know, nothing. You look at her ashrams, some are like abandoned and completely abandoned, dilapidated. Others are very modest. And you think, what? This is a very little modest thing, and there's just a few people there. There's hardly anything going on at all. It's like nothing happened, ever happened. The way is your own path. That you must take, and you must get through this. So there may be a lot of people in around the world just like myself who have been working on this intensely, not establishing any institution. Our group, you see, either male or female, the way that works out is all the same. It's all exactly the same thing, actually. And people waste all this time and weren't arguing about the differences, you know, between those two things. It's ridiculous. It's just avoiding the work, actually. Because your own wow is so intense, you don't want to establish any consensus. You don't want to establish an a competition. Say, this is enough. This is enough. This is all I can handle right now. That's all I can handle. I don't have any desire to do anything except just focus just on this right now. So the idea of let's be competitive or let's be really non-competitive, neither one of those. You know, let's push up here, who's you know faster, better, let's make sure that we don't go too fast for anybody here. Let's all have this group consensus here. It just goes along together and take votes, you know, all this, you know, bureaucracy. Let's establish this intense bureaucracy. The others are saying, no, you know, let's get this intense competitiveness here, you know. Neither way, those are the false light. Each one takes up the challenge of the day, wherever they're at. Getting to the wow of that day, the challenge of that day. Same discipline, quiet, sitting, sit quietly, focus intently, take up the challenge of getting to wow every day. So there is no answer to the world except your own effort. Your own spiritual practice is the answer to the problems of the world. There are teachers have struggled to try and develop some structure and institutions and stratifying. You're in this level, and try to, you know, do those things. But there isn't any one particular way that works. What works is each one longing to be free, the inner desire, longing, pull to be free, and then working on it on a consistent daily basis. That's what works. So if that's what you're doing, you're absolutely on the right track. And of course, this all seems ridiculously difficult because the false light and the continuity fear makes it seem so ridiculously complex and difficult. But it is enough to simply bring it to light, right? And you don't have to do anything about it. You just see it. Just seeing it. Brings a type of freedom from it. That's why I say it's very important to sit quietly. Don't struggle. Don't entertain. Don't struggle. Don't argue. Because in the effort to bring it to light, it's been brought to light now. You just have to have faith that bringing this to light is very helpful, very helpful. That's how you make progress. You just, you know, just sort of brought this whole situation, the false light, up into and saying, wow, there is this, you know, difficulty. There are these difficulties. The world, there is this great resistance here. There's this great skepticism about true freedom, absolute freedom. What they want to do is say limited freedom, and that's it. And so you get these various realms, and you think that this is it. And you can argue that going to these different realms helps you gradually increase your freedom. It doesn't seem to work out that way necessarily. Theoretically, again, you could see how that's possible. It doesn't seem to work out that way. What seems to work is concentrated effort to make breakthroughs that bring out this wow feeling where you need to sit quietly. I think all the teachers that I know have said that sitting quietly is extremely important and necessary. That enables you to absorb the shock of the breakthroughs. You need to move along the path very rapidly, briskly, with breakthrough after breakthrough after breakthrough. So in order to do this, you do have to be able to absorb the shock of the wow. It's like, wow, I can hardly believe what I just saw. It's like that, I can hardly believe what I just saw. Because the vision of oneness, again, is such a huge wow. It's the wow of all wows. It's the mother and the father of all wows. It is the wow of all wows, truly. So all these little wows that you go through, all these little wows that you go through, it's not like, hey, this realm is really great that I'm in. Wow, look at this, look at this. It's that, hey, there is no I to be in any realm. There is no realm, there is no I. See, that's a whole different wow. A whole different type of wow. Now, it's difficult to judge teachers or know what's going on, really, because there are many ways to work on the continuity fear. As long as you are doing the discipline and working at it every day and getting to wow and absorbing it, you know, then, you know, you're making progress, no matter what. They say truth is where you find it. I mean, as far as your own effort, you're going to get something. If you're really doing great, every situation, you'll get something out of it. It seems all helpful. Everything will seem helpful to you because it's pointing out to you what you need to work on, or, you know, it is, every situation can seem helpful. Instead of saying, none of this is helpful, I want a better place, none of this. Say, everything is helpful. Whatever happens to me is grace, is very helpful. It's all grace. It all points me to renewed effort. So in that way, everything, everyone's your teacher. Everyone's your guru, everyone's your teacher, which is true, is true. Ultimately, that is true, which is why self-study is so profound. I mean, doing the path every day, you have to use everything as your teacher. And you stop judging, spending all your time judging, and you just keep working, keep working. They just, I don't know. forget it. I don't know. I'm just going to keep working. Now, when the clarity gets into a struggle, which it absolutely will, that's fine. You realize you've been making progress. So you just maintain. Don't send your thoughts scurrying forward or backwards. Don't really need any thoughts. I have a severe continuity problem. This is the expression of it. That's what I already know, so I don't need to think about it, right? You have to say, well, maybe it's something else, maybe. No, we already know what it is, so thoughts don't need to arise. If we know what something is, thoughts don't need to arise. We don't realize this. Because we're not experiencing perfection. We believe we're experiencing preferences. So preferences are never what we really want. So we're always thinking about everything. Setting our thoughts backwards, setting our thoughts forwards. Right now is never what we truly want. Based on this feeling of preferences, it's like this isn't it. This isn't quite it. So we're thinking, well, what is it? Right, what is it? So when you feel this continuity burn, you say, wow, this is a strain. You know, it's like, what is this? This isn't it. You say, no, it is it. It is it right now. It's a continuity fear. I know what it is. Don't need to run forward, run backwards. I know what it is. And I know this is necessary. So I'm not going to start thinking about it. Now ultimately, the perfection. The absolute immaculate perfection of not perfect non-preferences. There's nothing to think about. No thoughts arise. You know what it is. Vision and oneness, you know what it is. So there's no thoughts going forwards, and there's not no thoughts, chain of thoughts going backwards. And if there's no chain of thinking whatsoever, is there thinking going on? Not really. No, not really. There's no need to take a thought for it. Not even a thought for now. Maybe we could say that's the final thought, the thought of now, or this thought of perfect. But even that is not necessary, because it is without thought. It doesn't need thought to be what it is. And so we recognize that this is inherently so. It's not something that we establish through some sort of effort, some sort of consideration. So now, see, I can tell I'm not making a big breakthrough now. I can tell that the continuity fear is really strong. That's fine. You become aware of this. You become aware. Each one becomes aware of the dynamics of their path, you see. You have to become aware of the dynamics of your path. You can't just get in a group and say, well, we really don't know. I don't know my dynamics. They don't know their dynamics because they're thinking of mine. I'm thinking of theirs. There's a passing the buck around. Nobody knows. Their dynamics of the path. You have to know the dynamics of your path. And so when you're not having like a real big breakthrough, you know you're leading up to one. I can tell I'm leading up to something here. Just like yesterday. I'm pushing for something. I'm not sure what it is. But don't struggle. Don't struggle with it. Accept the turbulence. Say, okay. Don't go too fast. Say, well, I can't go too fast now because there's so much turbulence. If you start veering off with your thoughts, then you know you're getting overloaded. You're getting overloaded, and then you need to bring yourself back and say, I don't have a thought problem, I have a continuity problem. I do not have any future problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have a past problem. I have a continuity problem. I have a very severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. thoughts of the past have absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of one has this value to me. Thoughts of the future have absolutely no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. And so you stay on track. And you might be saying, well, how long am I going to feel like this? Don't say, how long am I going to feel like this? Be patient. And you say, well, this is very uncomfortable. Yeah. It's very uncomfortable. Absolutely, the path is full of discomfort. But don't try to adjust your body to feel more comfortable. Okay, that's the mistake that many make. And they get into all this yoga work, thinking that's the answer. If I just learn how to adjust my body, I won't feel uncomfortable. That's not true. That's why I say quiet sitting, still sitting. You can be, you know, a little move. I move, but not much. Don't try to move away from the discomfort. In other words, don't try to move away from the discomfort. You may a little bit, sure. But by and large, don't. I can feel this deep, deep, deep discomfort here. Tremendous blockage here. Don't try to move away from it. Are starting to go into the future there. So, that's not it. That's not it. Watch your thoughts. It's very tricky, isn't it? Now, you're not trying to master anything. You're just trying to stay in the moment right now of your discomfort so you can make the breakthrough. You're not trying to become a quote-unquote spiritual master here. Okay? No. You're not trying to master the process. You're simply trying to minimize the delay. You're merely trying to be good enough so that you get the breakthrough. You get the breakthrough. Do not try and master the process. It slows you down. Slows you down. I say be ragged but right. Being ragged is fine. Because then people will spend their time saying, wait a minute, I'm working on trying to not get my thoughts here in the future. No, you're working on trying to make the breakthrough. You're working on sitting patiently until this continuity fear evaporates enough so that you can really see much more clearly. And you can feel, you know, that there's a lot of agitation. It's like, whoa. So, yeah, that's good. That's the burn. That's the spiritual burn. Then don't focus on it. Don't focus on it. Don't focus like it's some sort of achievement. It's not the goal. You just have to tolerate it. We're not after spiritual mastery. We're after the vision of oneness. It's very different. We're not trying to be spiritual masters. We are simply, our goal is to abide in the vision of oneness. People say, well, aren't you a spiritual master? And where's the process you mastered? No, not at all. That's not the goal. The goal is the vision of oneness. Vision of oneness is the only value there is. There is no other value. See, I'm not trying to be enlightened, the spiritual master, or guru, the saints, whatever you want to call it, self-realized, awakened. And only the vision of oneness has value to me. Only the vision of oneness, that's it. Because that's the vision, the preference-free vision. That's it, and that's reality. And getting used to that is what we have to do. There isn't any other choice. We can't change reality, so we have to accept reality as it is. And the vision of oneness is the way that this continuity fear gets finally completely dropped. It's gone. It's all evaporated, entirely evaporated. And we have to have it entirely evaporated. Continuity fear must be entirely evaporated. 100% evaporated. There is no specialness in reality, not even the tiniest bit of specialness in reality. Not even one example. Not even one example. See, the spiritual materialists, dualists, think, well, there's one example, that's fine. It's enough. Let's be happy, but then that's not a big deal. Oh, yes, it is. If there's one example of specialness, then all is special. If there's one example of boundness, all are bound. There's no freedom at all. If there's one example of lack of freedom, there's no freedom at all. So it's the complete lack of exception which is all important here. It's very different. The spiritual materialists have accepted an exception in their minds. They say, well, there must be some exception. So they're avoiding the path altogether. The entire path is based on your acceptance that there is no exceptions. And this is what Jesus puts forth in A Course in Miracles so intensely. And in the Bible too. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot make any exception. That is the whole point of it all. The whole purpose of the whole path. No exceptions. Vision of oneness, there's no exceptions. And that's what gives it its bliss. It's a different quality. It's not the ordinary happiness of the spiritual materialists who seem to be contented because they've made this deal with the false light. They feel contented because they're getting all this material. I can buy something else. I get something else. And that's not it. It's this unbounded bliss. There are no exceptions. Only this is what we truly wanted to see. This. So that's why the spiritual path is difficult, very difficult. And then the spiritual materialists say, hey, why don't you just do what we're doing? We just made a deal, we just made one, maybe one exception, a few exceptions, but that doesn't hurt. The rest of us can be free. There's a few that cannot be, or maybe just one that can't be free. But the rest of us, we can be free. So they crucified Jesus. Why? They said, you know what? Let's all agree that this one is the one that's not free. If we all agree there's only one that's not free, then the rest of us can be free. Yeah, so, that's the ideology. It's completely false. Completely false. And Jesus comes back and tells us, hey, no exceptions. God doesn't make exceptions. There are no exceptions to universal truth. Not one. And this is the root, the heart of the teaching. There is not one exception. And so, of course, this is very different than say, well, there's a few, or at least one, and that's called good. Totally different. Totally different. And of course, the spiritual materialists say, no, there's not a big difference between zero and one. Really? There's a fundamental difference between zero and one. One is no quantity, one is quantity. One is form, one is formless. How can you say there's no big difference there? How can you say there's a quantitative difference between one and zero? There's not a quantitative difference. There's a qualitative difference. And so they say, well, you know, maybe it's five. Oh, it's not five. Okay, three. There's a big difference between five and three. Or the difference between three and one. They're still talking about quantitative differences. That's the horizontal quantitative differences. No, when you go between one and zero, that's the vertical, as it were. I'm just using that as an example. You can use any example you want, but it's difference between quantity and quality. Zero doesn't have any quantity. It's not less than one. It's no quantity at all. There are zero exceptions. That is not some less exception than one. See, it's not a quantitative step. You might say it's a quantum step. It's not quantity. Well, maybe it's not even a quantum step, okay. Enlightenment, maybe I'd say enlightenment is not a quantum leap. It's a total non-leap. It's not a leap at all. Zero doesn't need to do any leaping. So, this is a better way to look at it. I mean, we think we need to make this quantum leap. No, actually we don't. The quantum leap will say, well, it's a big quantitative difference between one and zero, so this is going to be a huge leap, but it's still in the horizontal as far as quantity, right? We just think it's a profound difference in quantity. No, there's no it has nothing to do with quantity whatsoever. So there's no leap whatsoever. So this is the big breakthrough, the big leap, is to realize there is no big leap. Which is a shock to us. Because everything in our systems have to do with making some sort of leap, some sort of adjustment. And we think that at the heart of all this is the big leap. And now we're hearing there is no leap at all. There's just a gentle shift of attention from leaping to no leaping. From one to zero is just a gentle shift of attention. It's not a quantum leap at all. So why is this such a difficult step or non-step? Because with a leap, we always think it could be difficult and we could fail. So there seems to be some security and difficulty. Whereas if it's not a leap at all, and it's just a soft shift of attention, that's easy to do. So seeing how easy it is shocking and frightening. Because I say, oh my gosh, I might do it. This maybe in this next moment, I might do it. And that is what brings the fear up. So this is an intense burn right now. It's like, oh my gosh, I just realized how easy it is. That's scary. There is no leap. There is no quantum leap. So this is like ricocheting throughout the persona of all these collections of adjustments I've made. It's ricocheting everywhere here. So these insights, they do ricochet through your conceptual structure, adjustment structure. They ricochet all over you. Who knows where they're ping-ponging to? And it's just going. You know, I don't try to follow it. I just sort of checked in a little bit there. I realized it's really going all over the place. But it's very important. Don't put your attention on how it's ping-ponging, because ping-ponging all over the place. Just let it ping-pong. It will do whatever it's ping-ponging. It has, you know, it may have so much velocity, this insight may have so much energy or whatever. It may just keep ping-ponging and just like wearing everything away. It doesn't lose its inertia. It may not be losing its inertia. That's possible. You get an insight that has this infinite inertia, no inertia to it at all, and it's going to wake you up, actually. Right? It's not going to lose anything, no matter what structures it's bouncing off of. It's not going to lose any, it's not going to take on any inertia at all from any structure. So, you might say, I just swallowed the pill. Too late now. Just swallow the wake-up pill. So the strain you feel from insights is the freedom of the insight carries a certain degree of freedom, recognition of freedom. It's ping-ponging through all your conceptual structure, bouncing off this, because the conceptual structure bats it around, you know, Everything's like batting it around. I don't want this here, go over there, just over there. What do you call those in arcades with the balls that are bouncing all over the place. Can't remember the name. But it's like that. Bounce, 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 bounce. Bing, 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 bing. Pinball. Pinball. All those pinball arcade games. Balls are bouncing. Dum, 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 dum. I don't want this. I don't want it here. I don't want it here. But each time it bounces off of conceptual structure, that sexual structure is loosened up and expanded. It softened up somehow. It's like swallowing pills, spiritual pills, the path. You get the insights like swallowing a spiritual pill. And you say, oh wow, gotta swallow that one. What's gonna happen? I don't know. It's way better than taking drugs, spiritual path, because the pills that you're swallowing are way more intense than any drug you can take in terms of consequentialness. Really, I mean, dropping acid, taking mushrooms, mescaline, peyote, ecstasy, DMT, ethnogens of all types, whatever drugs, you take a drug and you swallow the pill. In other words, you take the drug and you say, wow, this is going to be a trip. This is going to be really cool. Like a thrill ride, an amusement park. But taking the spiritual pill of truth, it's kind of like, say, what did I just do? It's way more intense. In a different way. You're still completely functional. It doesn't affect your functionality at all. is a different scenario. This is deep. See, the drugs are superficial. They're very, you know, full of glitter and tinsel. So it seems like they're really cool, but they're very superficial. I know people think that they're very heavy because of geometric patterns, and they go, it's like I'm one, it's got another. It's very superficial. But this pill I just swallowed, you know, this is extremely profound. So these spiritual truths go down to an extremely profound level, you know, in the psyche of the conceptual structure. It gets all the way down, all the way down. Yeah, it's like, so you're saying, what did I just swallow? What's going to happen? Drug use is what happens in a spiritually materialistic, spiritually dualistic culture and world. That's what happens. People turn to drugs. They've basically denied the path, the spiritual path. So how do they get their sense of doing something profound? Through drugs, for sure, for sure. There's no comparison. There's no comparison. I mean, this is the pill of realization. Nobody needs to do anything. I don't need to do anything. No one needs to do anything. There are no preferences. It's just, it's a boundless profundity without beginning or end. Now, take a drug, you know there's a beginning, there's an end to it. This, you just took the drug, the pill, spiritual pill of no beginning and no end, no preference. You can't, one is quantity, one is quality. You can't compare. You cannot compare. So the spiritual dualists, you know, bring their drugs with them. They go to the teachers. Hey, I can do this too. I can get what you're saying through drugs. You know, I have the same experience. No, it's not. Nobody's ever truly awakened through taking drugs. Absolutely not. That's spiritual dualism. This one has a burn to it, big time, which is good. And my whole structure is shaking. You know, the whole conceptual structure is shaking, trembling. Now this trembling doesn't really reach the physical, so but my physical still, there's no reaction. The level of the physical body. The reactions are deeper. Emotional, etheric body, emotional body, mental body, causal body, and the reactions are there. So physically, there's nothing happening. You don't want stuff to be happening at the physical level. You know, it's the deeper levels that the happening is taking place. So physically, you just sit still, keep your body, you know, from being too restless. And as you're, you know, waiting for this deeper stuff, this burn, this deeper burn is going on, very intense. Some people use a symbology of fire. It's not literally fire, it's just symbology. The fire that burns everything, be consumed. That's just symbology. I see, I don't symbolize that way. I don't experience anything as fire. Some say energy, that's symbology too. I tend not to symbolize it, really. You can symbolize it any way you want to. It's what's more important is just to tolerate it. Whatever's taking place, I know it's working, so just focus on tolerating it instead of trying to, well, how do I symbolize this properly? Just forget it, just tolerate it. All groups and teachings seem to have they get some words in there. And so everyone has their own lingo. You go to this teacher and that teacher, so the lingo's different. They all have their sort of lingo. The thing is, the students all learn the lingo, and they say, okay, I think we're, maybe we're gonna pass this class. We figured out the lingo of the teacher. The real lingo is this no lingo, just tolerate it. Continuity, fear, tolerate it. Sit quietly, there's the lingo you need. Sit quietly and tolerate it. Don't let your thoughts go forward, don't let them go back. Don't anticipate, don't look to the past. Don't go off in imagination, fantasy. You just hear it. You just stay with the wow. Stay with the wow. Like, wow, there's a lot going on at deep levels here. Wow, I just swallowed the pill. Wow. Hold on. Just hold on and tolerate it. That's all you need. Because it's very intense. Very intense. Now, in the drug culture, of course, you have the shamans who are experts in taking you on drug trips, altered states of consciousness, etc. And so, there's really a big deal in the drug culture of who are the expert users, who knows how to take a trip, and then, you're supposed to have someone who's an expert if you're going to go on a drug trip. To help you with it, help you with the intensity of it. So, those in the know said, "Don't take drugs on your own, really, unless you really know what you're doing. You need to do it with a teacher, a shaman, who knows how to navigate you through the intensity of it." So, in the spiritual path, a non-drug path, a spiritual path. The intensity is way greater. So spiritual teachers are those who know how to help you navigate this intensity. And because the intensity is so much greater in a different way, so much deeper intensity, you really need to be dedicated and know all business, no nonsense. This is it's intense. Spiritual teachers are for those who are really up to the challenge, very intense up to the challenge of swallowing these pills of truth and the super depth of this, the depthlessness of this. It feels like there is no depth to it. I mean, it's endless depth here. It's not like there's some drug that's going to wear off. Truth doesn't wear off. Truth does not wear off. We're talking about eternity here. We're talking about eternal life. Eternal life doesn't go away. So the teachers are the ones who have a lot of experience with this and able to help others. Now, the students will refer to these teachers in different terms to try and boost their own reassurance in the teacher. Enlightened master, guru, realized one, the saint, the bodhisattva, the rabbi, the priest, or whatever you want to talk to the one who's... There's many, many different terms. The ascended master, the savior, the avatar, the divine one. Those who are taking these pills of truth, or on this, taking a spiritual trip, want to have faith in the teacher. They say, wow, this is so intense. I got to feel that this teacher is like the ultimate. Now, there's a question. Does the teacher discourage that or encourage it? Maybe they do neither. Because on one hand, if you discourage it, then the students say, whoa, this is too intense for me. So if you encourage it, I don't know. But as far as discouraging it, I want to struggle with this. I'm still in the intensity of this situation. They may not discourage it. It's possible. They're not. May not necessarily be a perfectly enlightened being. They may be someone who's very far along in handling these trips, and help. They can help others out. But others may say, "Well, I want to see you. I want to see you. I want to call you. You know, the perfect one." To reassure myself. And they may say, well, fine, that's okay. That if you need to say that and think of me that way, that's fine. But they may not be that way, actually. They may not be perfectly awakened. But are they wrong to not discourage it? No, maybe not. Maybe not. Maybe not. It's an interesting consideration. My case, I know that Jesus is perfect. I know that Sri Nanamayama is perfect. I know Maharishi is perfect. I know that Longchenpa is perfect, for example. I have no doubt about those teachers, ultimately. So, I feel safe. I feel safe, you know, to take this spiritual trip here, swallow that pill. But I'm at a distance. They're not here, so to speak. See, if they were here, it would be too intense, probably. So, as Jesus said, it's better for you if I'm not here. That's certainly right. So these great teachers, sometimes it's better if they're not here. And then we can have to find a teacher that is here also, who may not be, you know, perfect like these truly immaculate teachers, but we may project onto them our desire that we're with a perfect teacher, and they may not discourage that as possible. So you get these teachers who are, you know, they're not perfectly enlightened, who they may say that they are, or their students may say that they are. You get those situations, so I'm kind of like saying, huh. And the teacher doesn't really seem to discourage it. And yet they don't really seem to be encouraging it either. They're just saying, stick with the process. Stick with the process. You want to call me perfect, great, but stick with the process. Just focus, stick with this process. Focused on the process. You want to say, I'm the reincarnation of this. You want to say, I'm fine. Whatever you want to say, just stick with the process. They're not going to get caught up in arguing about that. Sri Nanamayama never said what she was. She said, whatever people wanted to call her, she said, fine. Wherever she went, people would insist that she was the deity that they worshipped. And she didn't argue with them. She didn't argue with him. She just said, stick with your work, get your spiritual practice, more. Everywhere she went, oh, my God, you're the God I worship, that kind of thing. But you're the deity. Finally come, I've been waiting for you. And she goes somewhere else, and then someone else insists that she was some other deity. Christians would come to her and they'd say, now God has a face. This is God, God has a face. Catholics and Christians would say that, they'd insist on it. She didn't say anything. And people say, who are you? She says, I'm whatever you take me to be. I'm whatever you take me to be. I am whatever you take me to be, you see. So there's a lot of teachers in the world, some, but the students say, you're God, you're Christ, you're Jesus, you're this. And they may just say, I'm whatever you take me to be. I'm not gonna argue any at this point because it's not relevant. What's relevant is you're on this, you're taking this spiritual pill and this is intense and you have to learn the discipline to do this, to get through it. You gotta discipline yourself. That's what's important here. You know, if you're in out of your fear of this intensity, you say, oh my, I think you're Jesus or something. Well, doesn't matter, because what's important is getting through this properly. Later on, you'll realize, I'm whatever you take me to be. Later on, you realize it doesn't matter. There's only one universal being. So it's possible. You know, I'm looking at this. I'm looking at it and saying that this is a possibility. Why don't teachers who are not perfect, you know, tell their followers, hey, no, don't. Now, Krishnamurti did that. Okay, Krishnamurti said, no, don't project anything onto me. Okay. And now, Sri Anandamayi Ma admonished him for that. I said, no, it's better to let them do that. She said, if you're really awake, it won't bother you, is what she told him. So Krishnamurti was not truly awake. There's something there in him. Or for whatever reason, he didn't want to be that seen that way. Okay. I won't say, I'm not going to say he wasn't truly awake. I don't know that. But he didn't. To him, it mattered. He didn't want to have himself looked at in any particular way because of experience with Theosophy and the Order of the Star and Vasant Leadbitter and Olcott and the Theosophical Society and all that. I think he had some trauma there. And so he hadn't worked that through somehow. He said, no, I just don't want to be seen. But Sri Anandamayi Ma's point was, people need that. And if you really know the unbound oneness, total lack of preferences of God, you know you aren't anything at all. You're free, your freedom. So people need to project onto you to help them out. Let them project, is her point. Let them project whatever they want to. I know none of it is true. I'm everything. Not I am everything, all is everything. All is everything. There's only all is everything. So you said, if it helps them, let them do it. I have no legacy or history. I'm not here for any legacy at all. I'm just here to help. All is everything. So it doesn't matter. You know, that's what she tried to get through to Krishnamurti, and he didn't accept it. Keep the thoughts back here. Let's go into the future there. Go into the future. future seems like such a safe place, happy, successful place, right? When you're in this burn, you want to imagine, like, hey, a time when I'm past this, now I'm enlightened or something. Don't do that. Don't do it. Stay with the burn. Whew. That's tricky. It's very tricky. Stay with your humility. Don't let your thoughts go to the future where you're successful. Don't let your thoughts go to the past where you were unsuccessful. There is no leap that needs to be made. Even a quantum leap doesn't need to be made. See, zero preferences is not a quantity. It's not a quantity. For the sake of language and speaking, it's easy. You can level confusion can confuse it. But we're not confused by that at all. Stay with the burn. Stay with the burn. It's funny that the spiritual dualists take drugs. They might go on a 5-hour trip. 2-hour. I mean, these days, I guess they have designer drugs that are half an hour. Quick. You know, quick trip. the heavy users, you know, 5-hour trip or something, or all day, you know, tripping all day. Well, if they can do that, can't we on the spiritual path, the non-drug path, cannot we stay on a trip for the spiritual trip for 5 hours or 4 hours or 3 or 2, whatever? Can we not? Can we? Are we right? Can we? Come on. If we want to compete, at least to compete with, you know, with that, with this, with the spiritual dualist drug path, at least we can compete with that and say, hey, if you can put in the effort to do that, or, you know, we can also put in the effort here. Come on. So, I mean, in some way, and this is just an idea I have, there can be some sort of competition that way. If you want to channel your competition, that's a great way to do it. And if you want to use the cooperation thing, using the yin-yang thing here, you would say, well, you do spiritual dualist drug path. If you can all cooperate, be pretty cooperative with your shamans and your politicians and leaders and etc., we can be at least equally cooperative with our teacher, with our helper, the one that walks beside us. We can be just as cooperative or more cooperative with that. And so use the yin-yang, male-female, to your advantage. The cooperativeness and the competitiveness. The competitiveness would be to take the challenge of the ordeal. The cooperativeness would be to cooperate with the instructions of the teacher and the help of the teacher. So that's the male-female thing there. Use both of them. And say, hey, we can do better than you. We can do at least good as you as far as effort. You know, don't do less effort than them. And I'm telling you, they put a lot of effort in. Just living in the Silicon Valley, you know, this is the heart of effort of the spiritual dualists. It's the heart of it. You can say it's the heart center of the spiritual dualism, New World Order. And, you know, they work their butts off. I mean, ton of effort. But I'm outworking them. I outworked them all. So there's that competitiveness there. You know, use the competitiveness to, in the right way. Said, you know, I'm not going to be ashamed. I'm not going to let them outwork me. No way. Because they will. If you want to be a slacker, they'll steamroll you. For sure. Now, of course, they're cheating by taking drugs and stimulants and all this stuff, you know. But that's okay. Got the Holy Spirit. They call that cheating, too. See, from their perspective, that's cheating. So we both think that the others are cheaters. That's okay. They say, that's not fair. You can't use miracles. You can't use the Holy Spirit. You can't.